Let us get started with the last session of the today's lecture. This is on finite volume method for the Navier-Stokes equations. So we started with pure conduction or pure diffusion, moved on to pure advection. Then we took the combination of the two, calling it as a convection. So in the last lecture, we had talked about two-dimensional unsteady state convection, which is a diffusion advection phenomenon. Now let us go to the Navier-Stokes equation. So in this, the objective of this topic, finite volume method, is to show you the discretization of the full Navier-Stokes equation. I'll start with the introduction, followed by the finite volume method for the continuity equation and the transport equation, which are momentum and energy, term by term. By this time, you already know that there are different types of discretization method: finite difference, finite volume, and finite element. And here we will discuss the finite volume method. This I had already mentioned that there are two approaches to get the discretized algebraic equation. You can get this from the governing partial differential equation, or you can also get it directly from the control volume from which this governing partial differential equation is derived. This is the method which I am discussing here, because I feel that this is more easy for the students to understand. I call it a physics based finite volume method. Just to refresh you back about the Navier-Stokes equation, here this is a two dimensional Navier-Stokes equation for incompressible flow. This is the continuity equation, this is the x momentum, this is the y momentum, and you have an edge equation. Now I had mentioned that if you look into the type of terms, basically you have unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term, and I said that this is like fill in the box type of problem. The small box represents the advected and the diffused variable, the big box represents the source term. In the energy equation also we have certain advected variable and source term, and in CFD we call this transport equation as having unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term, and other than that, whatever remains, we call that as a source term. Now let me ask you a question, that if you look into this equation, how many equations you have? Four equations: continuity, x momentum, y momentum, and energy for two dimensional case. How many unknown variables you have? U velocity, v velocity, pressures, and temperature. So now can you tell me which is the equation for u velocity, for v velocity, for temperature? Which equation is for u velocity? You have u in the other equation also, but why do you call this as an equation for u velocity? Because you have a term which gives you an idea that you can create a movie of u velocity by having this term. Why? Because here you have a term which has, which represents the temporal change of x momentum, and it includes temporal change of u velocity. Okay. So using this time marching, you can create a movie for u velocity. Using that, this you can obtain the temporal evolution of v velocity, and maybe you can create a velocity contour, a movie of velocity contour with respect to time. You can create movie for isotherms because you have this term here. Okay. So x momentum for u, y momentum for v, and energy equation for t. But so you are done with three variables. Which is the fourth variable? Pressure. So which is the equation for pressure? Tell me. You are left with one equation which you have not used, and there is one variable which is left. Okay, we are left with one equation, or we are left with one variable. So let us say that continuity equation is an equation for pressure. This is the biggest challenge, because when you look into the continuity equation, there is no pressure. In fact, if you look into the history of CFD, people were struggling. One of the main reason is that this continuity equation, we call it as an equation for pressure, but right now you don't have any pressure in this. So somehow we have to convert this into as an equation for pressure. This gave rise to pressure correction method and so on. I hope you can understand and appreciate what I'm saying. What is the main difficulty in solving this set of equations? Note that from we don't have any conservation law which says, which has a term for rate of change of pressure. This is for rate of change of x momentum, y momentum, internal energy, by which we can obtain temporal evolution of u velocity, v velocity, temperature respectively. But we do not have a conservation law which gives temporal evolution of pressure. In fact, this is one of the issues which causes a lot of challenges in solving this system of equation. So somehow we have to convert this continuity equation as an equation for pressure. This I'll discuss in more detail in the next topic, where we'll go to the solution methodology. But I just wanted to highlight this issue in this lecture. This finite volume method is basically discretization of advection term, unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term. It's a lot of repetition. I had done this since yesterday evening, so I'll do it very quickly because it's just a repetition. So I'll just show it quickly. So let us suppose these are your grid points, yellow circles, interior grid points, boundary points as blue circles. Now let us start the. This is something which is slightly different as far as the discretization. Till now I had not shown you the discretization of continuity equation. I am showing this for the first time, so I'll discuss it in little detail. Okay, now which law we apply? Law of conservation of mass or continuity equation. We represent it like this, but there are two levels of approximations which are involved. Let me go into it one by one. Actually, in your undergraduate or let us say when you derive the continuity equation, you represent this total mass flow rate on this phase as a product of mass flux mx into delta y, mx plus delta x small mx. Okay. So this is analogous to what I had shown for heat flux, advection, enthalpy flux and so on. So the first of level of approximation is the approximation which we use for fluxes. We had done this for conduction flux. We had done this for advection flux. We are doing the same thing here for mass flux. So this mass flux varies at point with respect to y here, with respect to x here, but we assume that its value is equal to the centroid value. Okay, so this is your expressing this mx plus delta x as the value of the mass flux at east centroid of the east phase multiplied by the surface area. This is surface averaging, which is the first level of approximation. So basically first level approximation is an approximation for the flux representation at a surface area at the centroid in general. The second level of approximation is that this mass flux is made up of product of density and normal velocity. So as far as this is concerned, it consists of UE. Normal velocity here is UE. So we need an approximation to calculate. Note that this type of interpolation of the velocity at the phase center I had shown you earlier in case of advection schemes also. But here, let me tell you, then when you talk of momentum flux, there are two velocities which are involved. One is the velocity, normal velocity, which contribute the mass flux, and there is a second velocity which is the advected variable. So for the advected variable, we use advection scheme, but whenever we want to calculate the mass flux, we do linear interpolations, although this causes little trouble, and there is one approach which is called a staggered grid, which I'll discuss in the next topic. But I just want to highlight that when you discretize mass flux, normal velocities come, and then you have to do some interpolation to calculate this mass flux at phase centers in terms of neighboring cell center. Note that for this we don't use any advection scheme. Advection scheme is different. This is a normal velocity that is used for the advected variable. When you talk of the velocities, there are two velocities, one coming from the mass flux, because when you look into the momentum flux, it's the product of mass flux. Let us say x momentum flux is the product of mass flux into u velocity. Y momentum flux is the product of mass flux into v velocity. But this mass flux also consists one velocity. Which is that velocity? Surface normal velocity. For that surface normal velocity, note that we don't use any advection scheme. We use advection scheme for the advected variable, which is u velocity for x momentum, v velocity for y momentum, and temperature for energy equation. To calculate the normal velocity, here I am showing you that we do linear interpolation. Okay, so that was the discretization of the continuity. This unstudy I had talked many times. It's just the volume averaging first level of approximation. Second level of approximation is discrete representation of the temporal gradient, and this is the general form of that. Advection term, I had mentioned earlier that the term here, this is the mass flux multiplied by u velocity multiplied by surface area. This is represents the rate at which this mass flux multiplied by surface area is mass flow rate. Mass flow rate multiplied by u velocity is, what is mass multiplied by u velocity? X momentum. Mass flow rate multiplied by u velocity is rate at which x momentum is entering into the control volume from this surface, and rate at which x momentum is leaving from this surface. So it is entering from this two surface, leaving from this two surface. So whatever is leaving, you add this two minus whatever is entering, you get the x momentum lost by the fluid in the control volume. Similarly, these are the for the x, y momentum lost by the fluid in the control volume. This is for the internal energy lost, or internal energy or enthalpy lost by the fluid in the control volume. So total advection, I discussed earlier that we can sum up, I discussed this in pure advection as well. And the advection flux, I had mentioned time and again that it is momentum flux in momentum equation and enthalpy flux in energy equation. The first level approximation in advection is the surface averaging to represent the fluxes at the face center. This I had discussed earlier. And the second level approximation is to calculate the value of the advected variable using an advection scheme. I had discussed this in detail taking an example of temperature, but indeed that is also applicable for momentum flux. I talked about what is advection scheme. This is just a refresh of that. These are the different advection scheme which we had discussed in the previous lecture. And I had also mentioned that the total advection represents net x momentum, net momentum lost by the fluid in the control volume for momentum equation, and net enthalpy lost by the fluid due to advection heat transfer in energy equation. The diffusion is what we did in conduction. For fluid flow analogous to conduction, you have viscous stresses. So whatever I am showing you are the viscous stresses. In my first lecture, I had shown you that for an incompressible flow, although sigma x is 2 mu del u by del x, sigma y x is 2 mu del v by del y plus del u by del x, but we can simplify it. And for an incompressible flow, I had mentioned that this viscous stresses in x direction can be expressed in terms of normal gradient of u velocity. Sigma x is, in general it is 2 mu del u by del x. This is mu del u by del y plus del v by del x. But in my first lecture, I had shown you that out of the two, if you take one and take this del v by del x, and if you apply continuity equation, it becomes 0. So for an incompressible flow, this is the simplified form of the viscous stresses. Now if you look into the simplified form, what you realize is here the gradient is with respect to x, here it is with respect to y. Now this x y is matching with which subscript? That of the plane or that of the direction? What is the first subscript? First subscript of plane direction. What is the direction of plane? Normal. So that way I can say that viscous stresses are directly proportional, is equal to expressed in terms of normal gradient of velocity. Viscous stresses in x direction in terms of normal gradient of u velocity. Viscous stresses in y direction in terms of normal gradient of v velocity. And heat conduction in terms of normal gradient of temperature. So note that this word normal gradient, which I am repeating time and again. So in CFD, we have to come up with a procedure to calculate the normal gradient. Calculation of normal gradient is easy in this case in Cartesian coordinate system, because in a normal gradient, when you draw a normal line, you get two yellow circles, that is cell centers. But when it's a complex shaped domain, when instead of this vertical, this is curved, then in that case it becomes much more complicated as far as calculation of the normal gradient is concerned. So in general, in CFD, to calculate the diffusion term, we need normal gradient, and for complex geometry, we need more complex mathematics, you can call, say that, to calculate this normal gradient. But there are methodologies to calculate the normal gradient. We discuss this in our regular course, but in this course, I don't think time will permit us to do that. There is some question.
Sir, I am not able to understand, sir, that previous slide. Shear stress tau yx. Sigma xy.
Yeah.
There should be another term also, no, sir. Mu times dou v by dou x plus dou u by dou y.
Correct.
Yeah.
That I had done in, if you look into my first lecture on introduction.
Yeah, that's fine, sir. But here we are omitting one term. Why?
No. The term which I am omitting, and I am not only omitting from here, I am also omitting one term from here.
Yeah.
It was twice of this.
Yes. Yeah.
So I have omitted one term from here, one term from here.
Yeah.
But in my first lecture, I had shown you that those two terms, if you do balancing, it comes out to be zero from continuity equation. I'll give you the lecture slide. You can go through it, and if you have further question, you can send me an email.
Okay.
For incompressible flow, it gets simplified. That simplification procedure I discussed in the first lecture. Any other question? This simplification actually makes things more general or easy, because the viscous stress in x direction, the viscous stress in y direction, the heat flux, all three we express in terms of normal gradients. No tangential gradients are involved. Okay, so that's why I am intentionally taking this simplified rather than a general case. But when it's a general case, we cannot handle it, we can handle it. But in this case, for incompressible flow, this course is limited to incompressible, so at least I can make it more easy for you. So total diffusion you can express in terms of normal gradient, as I mentioned. I am not intentionally showing you the arrow here. I had mentioned this earlier also, because heat fluxes are always normal. The viscous stresses in the x direction are normal in two planes and tangential in two planes. So arrow I am not saying, but the expression remains same. This is a diffusion coefficient, which is mu in case of fluid flow momentum equation, and conductivity in case of energy equation. And this eta represent normal direction. Small d is a diffusion flux. And what is this diffusion flux? This is viscous stress in momentum equation and conduction heat flux. It's a conduction heat flux in case of energy equation. And this is the two levels of approximation for conduction term. First level, surface averaging, to calculate the diffusion at a phase in terms of centroid value. And the second level of approximation is how to calculate the normal gradient. Okay. By piecewise linear approximation using a subsidiary law. What was that subsidiary law? Newton's law of viscosity in case of momentum equation, and Fourier law of heat conduction in case of energy equation. So this is a total diffusion term. The total diffusion term represented by capital D represent net viscous forces in the x direction and y direction for momentum equation, and net conduction heat transfer in case of energy equation. What is source term? Yeah, this is something different. So continuity equation and pressure is something different, which I had not discussed, because till now we were discussing about unsteady term, advection term, diffusion term. Okay, now in x momentum equation, we want pressure force in the x direction. So I need to know the variation of pressure on the faces. So there are two levels of approximations, and in the y direction, I need pressures in the horizontal faces. Let me go to the different levels of approximations which are involved. Like if you see pressure on this face, it is varying, is a function of y in general. Here also it is a function of y, here it is a function of x. And pressure is also a flux per unit area term, force per unit area. The first level approximation is surface averaging again, and representing this pressure in terms of the centroid value. And what will be the second level approximation? Expressing this pressure at face centers in terms of neighboring surge deltas. Note that always, actually in this what I call as physics based finite volume method, always there are two levels of approximation, and first level approximation is common. In general, it is a surface averaging. You have different types of fluxes, starting from conduction heat fluxes to, let us say, enthalpy flux to mass flux to pressure to viscous stresses. All this flux, when you study analytical fluid mechanics or heat transfer, you express it as x, x plus delta x, y, y plus delta y, where on the surface it varies. But here we are approximating as value at the centroid. So this is in general first level of approximation. What is the second level of approximation? Second level of approximation is this fluxes, when you write the expressions like conduction heat flux by Fourier law of heat conduction, viscous stresses by Newton's law of viscosity, mass flux you write as density multiplied by normal velocity, pressure force you write as pressure value of pressure. So out of this different fluxes, what you would realize is that in diffusion you need normal gradient of variable at the phase center. In all other fluxes you need value of the variable at the phase center. So here again you need value of a flux, that flux is pressure, okay, and that we express in terms of value at the centroid of the surface tension. This is the first level of approximation, and the second level is how to calculate pressure at phase centers in terms of neighboring cell center. This is like a central difference game, linear interpolation. Actually, the way I have shown you the two level of approximation for pressure is very much similar to what I discussed for mass fluxes. And for total heat generation, if there is a volumetric heat generation, the expression is very simple. Volumetric heat generation is uniform, so you just multiply by volume. This is the total heat generated by volumetric heat generation. So what is the final x momentum equation? Discretized form, this is the rate of change of x momentum in discrete form. This is the total x momentum, this is the total rate at which x momentum is lost by the fluid in the control. All these terms are rate terms, note that. This is the total viscous force in the x direction. This is the total pressure force in the x direction. Similarly, in the y direction. And in the energy equation, rate of change of enthalpy of the fluid inside the control volume is the total rate at which enthalpy is lost by the fluid inside the control volume. This is the total heat gained by conduction. This is the total heat gained by volumetric heat generation. So I think I had reached almost towards the end of this lecture. Some of the things which I had discussed here, you will get. I had written one chapter in one of the edited book, maybe 10 years back during my PhD. But at that time I was following the procedure which I saw in the books. It was Gavani equation based discretization. So in this chapter you will get that thing, but the approximations which I am discussing here in detail you can get here also. But whatever I am teaching, things have improved a lot as compared to this chapter. But one good thing about this chapter is that the complex geometry formulation which I was saying, you can get the detail of that in this chapter. So with this, I had come to the end of this topic.